If you're going to be doing development in an application space such as robotics, having an FPGA can be extremely handy, especially when you tie it together in an SoC like the Kria SOM available from AMD. So, Chetan, can you tell us about the new K24?
Yeah, thanks, Bill. Thanks for having me on today. And I'm happy to talk to you about the brand new K24 and what that means to the entire Kria portfolio of system on modules, right? So the K24 leverages the Zynq Ultrascale Plus adaptive SoC architecture used on other Kria SOMs. But what it also brings to the table is it brings a smaller form factor, scalable member to the Kria SOM family. And that smaller form factor is enabled by the info packaging technology that we innovated with our fab, TSMC, a couple of years ago. Info packaging, or integrated fan out for short, essentially takes the substrate layer that is very typically used in a BGA construction and removes that the need to have that from the packaging construct. So you're essentially going from die directly to the balls of the package. So by using a technology like this, we enable our customers to shrink the size of their printed circuit board when they're purchasing Zynq UltraScale Plus SoCs using InfoPackage. And similarly, it enabled us to shrink the size of the K24 SOM board itself into about roughly half the size of a credit card by us actually making use of this technology as well.
Now, how does this differ from the conventional packaging? Are there differences in terms of power requirements and so on in cooling?
So generally speaking, because you've got more direct connection from the die to your printed circuit board that you're going to be mounting on, you actually have greater thermal conductivity between the die, which obviously, you know, generates thermal energy and lets you dissipate that out onto your printed circuit board more sort of efficiently than with that middleman layer of the substrate.
Now, the architecture is effectively the same. Are we getting something that's going to be using less power than the prior version?
Yeah, so the K24 is a complementary solution in the Kria SOM portfolio along with the K26. And the K24 is really intended to be used where power, size are, you know, two of the key design criterias. And so typically what you're going to see is you're going to see, base power of a K24 SOM being, you know, a couple of watts, let's call it 2.5 watts, you know, moving up to maybe 5 watts in most cases. And there might be some outlier use cases where you're really pumping it because, of course, Bill, you know, anytime you're dealing with programmable logic or adaptive computing, your mileage is going to vary based off of what you program the device to do, both hardware and software programming.
So you mentioned that the K24 is complementary. What are the different application spaces that you might see a K26 used versus a K24? And in terms of the functionality of the two, how are they the same and how do they differ?
Sure, absolutely. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with a very common application, robotics, which makes use of both the K24 and K26, and you can actually see how both can be used in a common application. But before I do that, let me also quickly mention for those of your listeners out there that are not familiar, what a system on module is intended to do, right? System on modules, or SOMs, speed our customers' time to market by enabling hardware developers to focus on their application differentiation, and they enable software developers to start sooner with pre-built hardware. So even though Kria SOMs, both the K24 and the K26, are intended for production volumes, we offer starter kits that house these Kria SOMs respectively, so our customers can quickly prototype their application while they're designing their own carrier card for the production SOM to plug into. So with that in mind, if you take a look at robotics as an application, you can see how the various kits that we provide enable you to prototype a full robotic system very rapidly. The KR260, which we rolled out about a year ago, as the brains of the robot doing functions like motion planning, navigation, et cetera. The KB260 can be the eyes, inside of the camera on a vision-guided robot, running perception to aid with the navigation, and the KD240 can be the muscles controlling the movement and actuation. After prototyping, you can take those designs to production with a mix of K26 and K24 SOMs with your own custom carrier card. And this is, I think, especially highlighted in a application space like robotics, where many people, especially roboticists themselves, refer to robotics as the art of system integration, where you really are used to taking these like modular building blocks and piecing together a distributed embedded system out of them versus starting from scratch everywhere along the line.
Now, one of the things that I've noted on the development kits is obviously the heatsink versus the fan. I assume that something like the K24 is going to be ideal for smaller drones, for example, where power and cooling are going to be much more of a challenge.
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, where power and size are a key design criteria, we do think that the K24 is going to be the Kria SOM of choice for developers out there, right? But you can also see that even though the K24 is smaller in size, it doesn't necessarily mean that it can only, or it only needs to go into small form factor applications, right? So you can see on this slide here, you've got, you know, everything from robotics all the way to power generation to big iron medical systems, right? That are not necessarily all small in size, but you know, given either the requirements, the technical requirements of the application, or you know, other requirements, whether it be power or otherwise, you're able to get by with the K24 and not need the overhead of something beefier like the K26.
Okay. Well, shall we take a quick look at the K24 development kit that you have available? What kind of interfaces does it have, and what type of programming and development tools?
Absolutely. So yeah, the Kria KD240 drive starter kit is really our tool to enable easy adoption of the K24 SOM. You know, it enables a developer to work with the K24 SOM, and specifically in the case of motor control, you can be up and running controlling a motor in well under an hour. And so, one of the things that we're excited about is we're also going to be offering optional motor accessory packs, multiple motor accessory packs with the kit. But before we go there, just talking a little bit about what the kit itself has to offer, right? I'll highlight a couple of key attributes. First of all, the form factor of the kit is roughly the same size as the Kria starter kits that came before it. Along the top edge of the kit, you've got very popular common interfaces like micro SD, multiple USB, Ethernet, of course. CAN is important, and also along with CAN, other industrial networking interfaces. You'll notice on the upper right-hand corner, you've got three RJ45 connections. One of the RJ45s is really, connected directly to the processor subsystem on a Zynq UltraScale Plus, right? This is best effort Ethernet. We're talking to each other right now on a Zoom call, and that's best effort Ethernet. If there's a little bit of a drop in audio or video, it's a little annoying, but it's not the end of the world. In the case of industrial applications, you really can't afford to have a wide range of responsiveness, right? Like you need to have deterministic low latency communications and control. That's all enabled through industrial Ethernet. We've got a pair of RJ45s right next to the other RJ45 I was mentioning to you in the upper right-hand corner. Those are connected directly into the programmable logic of the K24. That enables you to have deterministic MACs running IEEE 1588, TSN, EtherCAT, Ethernet IP, pick your industrial networking standard of choice. And so that's why we have three Ethernet connections on there. Along the right-hand side, you've got all your typical connections that you would need for motors and sensors. And then back over to the bottom left, you've got the PMOD connection for expansion. So pretty much everything a typical developer will need to get started.
Well, very good. Looks like a great platform for development. How about on the software side? It's obviously has both an FPGA that can be programmed as well as ARM cores for running things like Linux.
Absolutely. So one of the things that we love to reference is the fact that we're ambidextrous, right? Most processors, as sort of by definition, are software reprogrammable. When you talk about adaptive computing, you talk about also hardware reprogrammable and software reprogrammable, right? And having those 2 degrees of freedom. So obviously we have the software reprogrammability through the ARM Cortex, quad-core ARM Cortex A53 and the dual R5 processors. You'll have Ubuntu operating system, Ubuntu server operating system, the long-term support version 22.04, 150,000 logic cells. You've got 132 I/O, 2 gigabytes of LPDDR4. You've also got, in the industrial grade version of the Kria SOM, you've got the 2 gigabytes of LPDDR4 are ECC protected for high reliability systems, as we have a number of customers are developing in the realm of functional safety, et cetera. We also have augmented the security capabilities of the Zynq UltraScale Plus architecture with a TPM 2.0. So Zynq UltraScale Plus in and of itself has hardware root of trust built in, but we augment that for additional secure and measured boot use cases with the TPM 2.0. Now, when you have that as your baseline as a software developer, you can take that and you can obviously, you know, you're going to get right out of the box, you're going to get the, you know, Ubuntu Linux right away. But one of the things that we're really excited about is, you know, given the software flows that AMD has had over the last few years, right, we have Vivado for RTL developers. We have Vitus for C or C++ developers that want to, you know, code in a language more familiar to them and implement that design in, you know, in the programmable logic. But new for K24, one of the things that we've really tried to innovate is really design flows that work very nicely and seamlessly with MATLAB Simulink, as well as for Python developers using our Pink infrastructure. And Bill, you know, if you kind of look at it in the bigger picture and you take a step back, right? And if you look at what we've done across all the different Kria kits and different Kria SOMs that we've rolled out over time, you can see that there's quite a wide array of developer types that we really cater to with Kria. With the K26 and the KR260 and the KV260, we talked about flows for roboticists with ROS 2. And we talked about, you know, having support for TensorFlow and Cafe and PyTorch and your typical AI you know, frameworks. So the great thing about Kria is, even though K24 is new and we are focusing on MATLAB Simulink and we're focusing on, you know, Python, we still support everything that we have supported in our previous SOMs and previous kits with the K24 as well.
So you mentioned the motor control. Is there more that's going to be available on that?
Yeah, absolutely. So even though we call the KD240 the drive starter kit, you do need to optionally purchase a motor control accessory pack to go along with it. And we actually are going to be offering 2 different motor accessories. So right at the time of launch, September 19th, we're going to be offering the AMD Kria KD240 motor accessory pack. It involves a brushless DC motor with a quadrature encoder. So a quadrature encoder, for those who are not familiar, basically lets you tell the controller, in this case, the K24, exactly what position the motor in is at all times. You don't have to spin the motor. You don't have to, you know, do anything. It knows where the motor is. And so that enables you to do field-oriented control type applications as well. Now we have another kit that's coming out very soon. And this is coming through a company called Rev Robotics. Rev Robotics is one of the leading names in STEM education. We're using their Neo 550 brushless motor. This has got Hall sensors in it. It doesn't have the full quadrature encoder. So you really do have to spin this thing up to speed a little bit to be able to understand exactly what position the motor is in. It has gearbox. The kit also comes with 2 configurations, right? So for those of you maybe that either have children at home or you're a big kid yourself, you're probably familiar with those Lego kits that were like 2-in-1, 3-in-1 Lego kits. So similarly, taking a page out of that, we've worked with Rev to build a 2-in-1 motor accessory kit that lets you either build a ball shooter or a very simple robotic arm with this kit. You can kind of reconfigure the parts and so forth. And while this is a lot of fun, But these are, there's also a lot of tech and a lot of math that goes behind the scenes with this, because these are inherently unstable systems that require DSP processing of the highest magnitude to produce consistent outcomes, right? You don't want one person dropping a ball into the ball shooter at one angle, another person dropping it in at a different angle and having it shoot and spray all over the place. You want to get the predictable outcomes regardless of how it enters into the chute. So DSP processing enables that. We can even go a step further with the ball shooter. We are even going to enable a USB camera to be plugged into the KD240, because the KD240's got USB ports. You're going to be able to add AI processing to the ball shooter to help you with targeting your ball shooter kit. So loads of fun, but loads of math and control loops, behind the scenes to enable all that fun.
Well, with all of these various platforms, is there an app store for getting some software and firmware that's going to work with these?
Yeah, absolutely, Bill. So one of the things that when we introduced Kria for the first time 2 years ago, we rolled out at the time, which was, sort of unheard of, a kind of an industrial embedded app store. And so now, 2 years later, the app store has grown with the KV260 kits, the KV260 apps, the KR260 apps, and now the KD240 apps. The app store will grow to over 25 different apps available for users to download. They can obviously download it maybe the more traditional or old school way, which is go to the website, but probably the more common way that most of our users tend to download things is directly onto the targeted hardware. So you can literally type in a command and basically grab that image right off, right off the net and bring it and download it directly onto your target platform and be up and running very, very fast with a wide variety of applications ranging from communications, control, HMI, obviously, as we're talking about here, right, with more physical motor control, spinning things, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a great diverse app store with apps filled from both AMD as well as our ecosystem.
So wrapping up, could we talk a little bit about how you see the K24 fitting into this family?
Yeah, absolutely. Right. So, AMD has now expanded the Kria family offering to include a range of complementary products. So we've now got three starter kits and the K24 and K26 SOM. The portfolio offers our developers and our users lots of options and support for lots of different use cases, development flows, as we talked about, Bill, price, power, size combinations, really enabling them to target a wide range of production products. Customers can purchase any of these products online at AMD.com, various online distributors, and through traditional distribution channels as well. We think the introduction of the K24 SOM will not be not only a great product in and of itself, but the scalability opportunity will have a multiplicative effect across the portfolio. And the reason for that is because the K24 is connector compatible with the K26, right? So you can develop a common carrier card for both the K24 and the K26 and swap between the two. And I think you noticed this already, Bill, right? I mean, the K24 is low power enough to not require active cooling. The other thing I'll quickly mention about the portfolio, which is unique from traditional AMD chip down products, is that pricing is volume independent. Whether you're buying 1, 10, 100, or 1,000 of these devices, the pricing that you see here is the pricing that we offer online at AMD.com and through the majority of our distribution partners offer.
Well, very good. I'm looking forward to checking one of these things out in person. Thanks very much.